Jesus' first esoteric discourse, next on One Gospel. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This one came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know you are a teacher that came from God, for no man can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." Jesus answered him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born from above, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter into his mother's womb a second time and be born?" Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of the water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. In this manner is everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus answered him, "How can these things happen?" Jesus answered him, "Are you the rabbi of Israel and do not know these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak what we know and testify what we have seen, and you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how shall you believe if I tell you the heavenly things? And no man has ascended up to the heaven except he who came down from the heaven, the Son of Man who is in the heaven. And as Moshe lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. He who believes in him is not judged, but he who does not believe is judged already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and men love the darkness rather than the light, for their works were evil. For everyone that practices evil hates the light, neither comes to the light, that his works should not be exposed. But he who does the truth comes to the light, that his works may be clearly seen, that they are worked by God." So we're going to continue through this discussion. This will be the second episode covering that. So the last episode went through a lot of interesting topics. Today we're going to talk about, first, Moses lifting up the serpent in the wilderness. This is described in the Torah in Numbers 21, 4 through 9.
"And they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom, and the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. And the people spake against God and against Moses, 'Wherefore have ye brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water, and our soul loatheth this light bread. And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel died. Therefore the people came to Moses and said, 'We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he take away the serpent from us.' And Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said unto Moses, 'Make thee a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole, And it shall come to pass that every one that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass, and put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived.
So that's quite a story. So when Jesus said that he'll be lifted up, what does that mean?
Then Jesus said to them, when you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and I do nothing originating of myself, but I speak these things as my Father has taught me, and he who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, because I always do the things that please him. Jesus answered, this voice did not come because of me, but for your sake, now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world shall be cast out. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all to me. He said this, signifying by what death he was about to die.
So we see that this story about Moses having the snake up on a pole was a picture of Jesus being lifted up in crucifixion. Crucifixion didn't exist at the time of the Torah, so this is symbolic at the time. But this shows you that Jesus, from the very beginning, even before his public ministry really began, he was already looking to his ultimate death. So this is the first time Jesus mentioned eternal life. He actually defines eternal life later to his disciples.
As you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him, and this is life eternal. And they might know you, the only true God, and Jesus, Messiah, whom you have sent.
Faith in him is consistently characterized as the key to eternal life.
He who believes in the Son has eternal life, and he who does not believe in the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed out of the death into life. And you do not have his word remaining in you, because whom he has sent, him you do not believe. You search the sacred writings because you think that you have eternal life in them, and these are they which testify concerning me. You are not willing to come to me that you may have life. I do not receive glory from men, but I know you, that you do not have the love of God in you. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which remains to eternal life, which the Son of Man shall give to you. For God the Father has set his seal on him. Then they said to him, what shall we do, that we might labor for God's works? Jesus answered them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. This is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have eternal life, and I will raise him up in the last day. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me has eternal life.
But eternal life is also a gift from Jesus.
But whoever drinks from the water that I shall give to him shall never thirst, but the water that I will give to him will become a fountain of water in him, springing up into eternal life. Then Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you've no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. And I will raise him up on the last day, for my flesh truly is food, and my blood truly is drink. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, I live because of the Father. Indeed, he who eats me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, not as your fathers ate manna and are dead. He who eats this bread shall live forever. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give to them eternal life. They shall never perish, neither shall anyone pluck them out of my hand.
Eternal life is also related to God's command.
He who rejects me and does not receive my words has one who judges him. The word that I have spoken, the same will judge him in the last day. For I have not spoken for myself, but the Father who sent me gave me a commandment, what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his commandment is an eternal life. Therefore, whatever I speak, just as the Father said to me, so I speak.
Here we see that inheriting eternal life is related to obedience and equivalent to entering the kingdom of God.
When he was going on the road, one ruler came running and knelt before him and asked him, "Good Rabbi, what good thing shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except one, God. But if you want to enter into the life, keep the commandments." He said to him, "What kind?" Jesus said, "You know the commandments. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and your mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." And the young man said to him, "Rabbi, I have observed all these from my youth. What do I yet lack?" When Jesus heard these things, he looked at him, loved him, and said to him, "You lack one thing yet. If you want to be complete, go sell all your possessions and distribute it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come take up the cross and follow me." And when the young man heard, he became very sorrowful at the word. He went away sorrowful, for he had many possessions and was exceedingly rich. When Jesus saw that he became very sorrowful, he looked around and said to his disciples, "Truly I say to you, how hard it is for a rich man, those with riches, to enter the kingdom of God of heavens." And when his disciples heard it, they were exceedingly amazed beyond measure, saying among themselves, "But who then can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said to them, "With men this is impossible, but not with God. For the things which are impossible with men are possible with God. With God all things are possible." Then Peter began to say to him, "Look, we've left all, we've followed you. Therefore, what shall we have?" Jesus said to them, "Truly I say to you, that you who have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man will sit on the throne of his glory, you will also sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. There is no one who has left houses, brothers, sisters, father, mother, wife, children, or lands for the sake of my name, the gospel and the kingdom of God, who will not receive 100-fold back or much more. In this present time, houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and lands with persecutions. In the age to come, one will inherit eternal life, and many who have been first shall be last, and the last first."
In a parable of the final judgment, eternal life and punishment are related to how one loves others, and by extension, Jesus.
Then the king will say to those on his right hand, "Come, ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to me." Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and gave you drink? And when did we see you as a stranger and took you in, or naked and clothed you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and came to you? And the king will answer and say to them, truly I say to you, as much as you have done to the one of the least of these, my brothers, you have done it to me. Then he will also say to those on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not take me in. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not look after me. Then they will also answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not serve you? Then he will answer them, saying, truly I say to you, inasmuch as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these shall go away into the eternal punishment, and the righteous into eternal life.
So what was the context of eternal life that Nicodemus would have been familiar with? At this time in the ancient world, when Greek philosophy was a part of the education of the elite, Nicodemus was likely familiar with Socrates' belief that the soul was immortal. This is described in a discourse between Glaucon and Socrates in Book 10 of Plato's Republic.
And should an immortal being seriously think of this little space rather than of the whole? Of the whole, certainly. But why do you ask? And are you not aware, I said, that the soul of a man is immortal and imperishable? He looked at me in astonishment and said, no, by heaven. And are you really prepared to maintain this? Yes, I said, I ought to be, and you too. There's no difficulty in proving it. I see a great difficulty, but I should like to hear you state the argument of which you make so light. Listen then, I am attending, but the soul which cannot be destroyed by an evil, whether inherent or external, must exist forever, and if existing forever, must be immortal. Certainly. That is the conclusion, I said, and if a true conclusion, then the souls must always be the same. For if none of them be destroyed, they will not diminish in number, neither will they increase. For the increase of the immortal natures must come from something mortal, and all things would thus end in immortality.
The Torah doesn't address eternal life, but following God and his commandments do lead to life.
See, I have set before thee this day life and good, and death and evil, in that I command thee this day to love the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways, and keep his commandments, and his statutes, and his judgments, that thou mayest live and multiply. And the Lord thy God shall bless thee in the land whither thou goest to possess it. But if thine heart turn away, so that thou wilt not hear, but shalt be drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I denounce unto you this day that ye shall surely perish, and that ye shall not prolong your days upon the land, whither thou passest over the Jordan to go to possess it. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live, that thou mayest love the Lord thy God, and thou mayest obey his voice, and that thou mayest cleave unto him, for he is thy life and the length of thy days, that thou mayest dwell in the land which the Lord sware unto the fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, to give them.
Eternal life is also found in Hebrew scriptures.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And at the time shall Michael stand up, the great prince, which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to the same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be written in the book. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever.
Later writings in the Septuagint also discusses eternal life.
The destruction of the sinner is forever, and he will not be remembered when God shows care for the righteous. This is the portion of the sinners forever, but those who fear the Lord will rise up to the eternal life, and their life will be in the Lord's light, and it will never cease. And when he was at the last gasp, he said, Thou like a fury takest us out of this present life, but the King of the world shall raise us up, who has died for his laws, unto everlasting life. Now therefore deal with me as it seemeth blessed unto thee, and command my spirit to be taken from me, that I may be dissolved and become earth, for it is profitable for me to die rather than to live, because I have heard false reproaches and have much sorrow. Command therefore that I may now be delivered out of this distress, and go into the everlasting place. Turn not thy face away from me.
God's love was the motivation for Jesus' life and his mission.
But God commandeth his love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. But God, who is rich in mercy for his great love, wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in our sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. In this was manifested the love of God towards us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us, and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins.
There are two aspects of this judgment. The first is later in this passage.
And this is a judgment that the light has come into the world, and men love the darkness rather than the light, for their works were evil.
The next comes at the time of Jesus' death and resurrection.
Jesus answered, "This voice did not come because of me, but for your sake. Now is the judgment of the world. Now the ruler of this world shall be cast out, and I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all to me."
Everyone that practices evil hates the light. This is described in more detail by Job.
Men groan from out of the city, and the soul of the wounded crieth out. Yet God layeth not folly to them. They are those that rebel against the light. They know not the ways thereof, nor abide in the paths thereof. The murderer rising with the light killeth the poor and needy, and in the light is as a thief. The eye also of the adulterer waiteth for the twilight, saying, "No eye shall see me," and disguiseth his face. In the dark they dig through houses, which they have marked for themselves in the daytime. They know not the light, for the morning is to them even as the shadow of death. If one know them, they are in the terrors of the shadows of death.
Jesus spoke to Nicodemus of multiple new spiritual concepts in this discourse. He started off by talking about rebirth, spiritual rebirth, being born from above. He talked about his special existence, where he was both present there with Nicodemus and also in heaven simultaneously. He says that this same Son of Man is God's only Son and the light in the world. He He says that whoever believes in this Son will not be judged or die, but those who don't believe are judged already. And he connected these new teachings to concepts that Nicodemus thought he understood. He thought he understood the kingdom of God and eternal life. Moses' brazen servant, the final judgment. But Jesus turned all these ideas he thought he knew on their head. And there's more. The Son of Man, who hasn't even been in the public's eye for more than a few weeks, he's doomed to being rejected because men love darkness more than the light. So Jesus knew this from the beginning. But he also knew and told Nicodemus that through him being rejected, that the world might be saved. Nicodemus, in such a short conversation, was given a revelation that Jesus' later apostles wouldn't receive for some time. But the meaning and significance of these words weren't meant to be revealed for even longer. But in the meantime, because this was Jesus' first esoteric teaching, this was a private teaching, but the exoteric mission, his public ministry in both words and deed, was about to begin. See you next time.